book of Psalms, we find these words. God is our strength and refuge, a very present help in trouble. In the book of Deuteronomy, we find these words. The eternal God is thy refuge, and underneath are the everlasting arms. From the book of Job, for I know that my Redeemer liveth, and that he shall stand at the latter day upon the earth. And though after my skin worms destroy this body, yet in my flesh shall I see God, whom I shall see for myself, and mine eyes shall behold, and not another, though my reins be consumed within me. St. Paul writes, for I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. And some words of Jesus himself. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. We meet this afternoon in the name of Jesus Christ, who died and was raised to the glory of God the Father. Grace, mercy, and peace be with you all. And welcome to St. Eustatius Parish Church here in Tavistock this afternoon as we gather to give thanks for the life of General Sir Frank Edward Kitson, to say our final farewells to him in this earthly life. Welcome also to those of you who are joining us online, and a special welcome to Mo. This morning, Frank's family gathered at St. Leonard's Church in Sheepstor to commit his body to be buried. And now we gather with them as we come here to this house of prayer where Frank and Elizabeth were married all those years ago, to commend him to God, our merciful Redeemer and Judge, to surround Lady Elizabeth and the family with our love and prayers, and to give thanks for his life, a life well lived. Today, of course, is an opportunity for you to call to mind your own memories of Frank, whether it was the way he smiled or the way he laughed, a particular turn of phrase that he had, or an experience that you shared together. I encourage you to treasure those memories today. In a sense, they are Frank's final gift to you. And after the service, you're all warmly invited across the road to the Bedford Hotel for refreshments and an opportunity to share those memories and to raise a glass to Frank. But now, as we stand, so let us pray. God of all consolation, your Son, Jesus Christ, was moved to tears at the grave of Lazarus, his friend. Look with compassion on your children in their loss. Give to troubled hearts the light of hope, and strengthen in us the gift of faith in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We remain standing to sing our opening hymn, Love Divine. If you do not have one of the white service sheets in front of you, it is hymn number 621 in the blue hymn books in the pews.
Amen.
Ye that do truly and earnestly repent you of your sins, and are in love and charity with your neighbours, and intend to lead a new life, following the commandments of God, and walking from henceforth in his holy ways, draw near with faith, and take this holy sacrament to your comfort, and make your humble confession to Almighty God. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things, judge of all men, we acknowledge and bewail our manifold sins and wickedness, which we from time to time most grievously have committed, by thought, word, and deed, against thy divine majesty, provoking most justly thy wrath and indignation against us. We do earnestly repent, and are heartily sorry for these our misdoings. The remembrance of them is grievous unto us, the burden of them is intolerable. Have mercy upon us, have mercy upon us, most merciful Father, for thy Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake. Forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may ever hereafter serve and please thee in newness of life, to the honour and glory of thy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, our heavenly Father, who of his great mercy hath promised forgiveness of sins to all them that with hearty repentance and true faith turn unto him, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Would you please be seated? We're now going to hear the first of our readings, and for the benefit of those who are not physically present with us but are watching online, this comes from the Canterbury Tales. It's called The Knight, and Connie Little is going to read it for us.
There was a knight, a most distinguished man, who from that day on which he first began to ride abroad had followed chivalry, truth, honour, generousness, and courtesy. He was of sovereign value in all eyes, and though so much distinguished, he was wise. And in his bearing, modest as a maid, he never yet a boorish thing had said. In all his life to any, come what might, he was a true, a perfect, gentle knight.
Our next reading is called Success, written by Robert Louis Stevenson and read for us now by Edward Knowles.
The man is a success who has lived well, laughed often, and loved much, who has gained the respect of intelligent men and the love of children, who has filled his niche and accomplished his task, who leaves the world better than he found it, whether by an improved poppy, a perfect poem, or a rescued soul, who never lacked appreciation of Earth's beauty or failed to express it, who looked for the best in others and who gave the best he had.
I had been planning to speak from the pulpit, but I couldn't possibly stand on the shoulders of my old boss. Sixty-two years ago, a happy event took place in this church when Major Frank Kitson married Miss Elizabeth Spencer. Later in life, Frank wrote in his last book that the best thing he ever did in his life was to persuade Elizabeth to marry him. But today, we're gathered here for a different reason. Today, we've come to remember and say goodbye to General Sir Frank Kitson and to show our sympathy and support for Lady Kitson and her family. Frank Edward Kitson was born in December 1926 and became known for his outstanding career in the Army. There are not many people who know that his amazing career was very nearly ended before it had begun. As an eight-year-old, he only just survived a severe attack of asthma. He was even pronounced dead by a doctor, whose faulty diagnosis remained unexplained. But it was the asthma that prevented Frank from joining the Navy to follow his father, who had been a vice admiral. Instead, Frank joined the Army, and we were so lucky to have him. Frank was also a successful author, a good horseman, a keen shot, and a dab hand with his rods. He had a reputation for no-nonsense, clear thinking, and a long list of likes and dislikes. Apart from his love of hunting, shooting, and fishing, and birdwatching, he liked the 1662 Book of Common Prayer and the King James Bible. He hated drill, facial hair, complacency, sycophancy. He couldn't see the point of golf or skiing. And sometimes his aloof manner meant that many people were scared of him. Yes, he had firm opinions on just about everything, but he was prepared to listen to well-argued views, and he didn't stand on ceremony. Hidden from many people was his puckish sense of humor. He would often be seen shaking with mirth at some amusing anecdote or cock-up. His sense of humor was certainly at work on an occasion during his time as a major general when he was commandant of a staff college. In one of the large anterooms there was an enormous carpet. It had become rather tired, and the colonel in charge of administration decided it had to be replaced, which would involve considerable expense. Being a careful fellow, he sought and received much information about carpets and prices, and he canvassed opinions from a variety of other officers. The great day came when, with his choice at last made, and a swatch of the chosen carpet in his hand, he entered the commandant's office to seek that final approval. As those of you who've shopped for a carpet will know, a swatch is but a small piece of carpet, 1 foot by 1 foot. And as the colonel threw it to the ground, he said, "And that, General, is what we have chosen." Frank looked at it briefly and said, "It's a bit small, isn't it?" Frank was a dedicated and successful career soldier, which is how he appeared to the wider world. At home, he was a devoted husband and a tolerant family man, and we'll be hearing more about that side of his life later. Frank's father, the Vice Admiral, was in the Navy, obviously, but Frank was unable to follow him because of the asthma. So he went for a medical examination to join the Army. Frank said the medical officer wasn't interested in asthma. He was quite satisfied because Frank had two arms and two legs. Frank became a rifleman at the end of December 1944. And after basic training and time as an officer cadet, he got his commission in the Rifle Brigade in February 1946. During his early years in the regiment stationed in Germany, Frank had plenty of opportunities to join in game shooting, and he indulged his love of horses while hunting, show jumping, and competing in various army competitions, although he said himself this was done without much success. And on one occasion, he suffered concussion after a bad fall during a point-to-point. His army career began to take off when he was posted to Kenya in 1953. He became a military intelligence officer attached to the local police special branch as they played their part in the long-running campaign against the Mau Mau gangs that were raiding and terrorizing both villagers and white settlers. Frank started out with one assistant British officer and a few locals. Within a year, the group working for him numbered 6 officers, 13 sergeants, and a large number of loyal Kenyans and former terrorists, amounting to around 200 all told. Under his leadership, this unconventional organization produced not only better intelligence, but also managed to reduce the number of attacks in their area and a reduction in gang members. So much so that his methods, which he had developed from scratch, were being replicated in other areas of what was then still a British colony. For his success in Kenya, Frank was awarded a military cross. And this was followed by a second one, we call it a bar, at the end of his next appointment, this time back serving with the Rifle Brigade in Malaya, where he pursued and further developed his novel approach on protracted operations in the jungle on light scales and often at night, as he successfully dealt with Chinese communist terrorists. Frank made no secret that his least favorite jobs were in the War Office and later the MOD. As a major in the late 60s, he was working in a branch concerned with affairs in the Middle East, and thus he became involved in the unique and complex problems of Oman, which enabled him to leave his desk for a period and visit the area, where, of course, Major Kitson made clear to senior local bosses exactly how the campaign to clear distance from the Jebel Akhdar could be advanced. In due course, an SAS detachment arrived and successfully cleared the rebellious tribesmen from their positions, although it failed to capture the 3 ringleaders who departed to Saudi Arabia and continued to cause trouble in the area for several more years. Having been an instructor at the Royal Naval College at Greenwich for a year, Frank spent a further 6 months in America as a student at their Armed Forces Staff College. Most students on such courses sit and listen to more experienced lecturers, but in Frank's case, he found himself in demand speaking of his own experience in the Kenyan and Malayan operations, often to audiences of senior American officers. Frank's ideas and unique experience were so valued that he was still being consulted by others long after he'd retired, including General David Petraeus, before the American so-called surge in Iraq, and later still by senior British officers involved in the difficult Afghanistan operation. Let's go back to 1962 now for an important event as Frank married Elizabeth, which, and I repeat, he said was the best thing he did in his life. After an eventful honeymoon in Kenya, the newly married couple went to Cyprus in November as Frank returned to regimental duty with the Rifle Brigade, now styled 3rd Battalion of the Green Jackets. The battalion's role was to protect the sovereign base areas at Episcopi and Decalia. This was not a demanding task. Neither was Frank's job as second in command. He had plenty of time to take on a pack of hounds, becoming master and huntsman, while Elizabeth became the whipper-in. But this happy and relaxed life changed over the Christmas period in 1962, when sporadic fighting between the Greek and Turkish Cypriots developed to the extent that it threatened to bring about war between Greece and Turkey. The battalion was ordered to move to Nicosia, and once again, Like his experience in Malaya and Kenya, Frank started from scratch to build up an intelligence network so essential in dealing with such situations. Then came another change in his career when the commander of the dramatically increased number of British troops engaged in this peacekeeping operation, General Mike Carver, later to be the professional head of the army, borrowed Frank to be his intelligence staff officer, a job which lasted for several weeks until a United Nations force was set up in March 1963, and that is still in place today. After another spell working in Whitehall, Frank took over as a lieutenant colonel in command of the 1st Battalion of the Green Jackets, and that's where I began to learn the likes and dislikes of a man I quickly came to admire and respect. After only a few months in command, Frank took our battalion to Cyprus as part of the UN force operating between the still rival Greek and Turkish Cypriots. When this rivalry suddenly developed into a full-scale military attack on two Turkish Cypriot villages in my company area, I found at one stage my commanding officer squeezing in beside me under my desk as ill-directed shells from the guns of the Greek National Guard exploded a bit too close for comfort. Although Frank acquired a formidable reputation in the army, and to some he appeared distant, difficult to please, and given to caustic comment, this was not my experience, but he did acknowledge that he had very different attitudes to most of his contemporaries. I always found him polite, fair-minded, and more flexible than storytellers made out. It's true he could be outspoken and intolerant of inaccurate work and sloppy actions. He hated unnecessary fuss, and sycophants were not tolerated. On one occasion, a young aspiring officer said, "I've just read your book, General, from beginning to end." And Frank said, "It'd be very foolish to read it any other way." I was not alone in collecting Kitson stories. One day in Tidworth, the regimental sergeant major rushed out of his office and fell in step beside Frank as he left battalion headquarters. Frank asked the RSM where he was going, and the RSM naturally said he didn't know, but he thought he ought to accompany his commanding officer as he went around the barracks. Frank replied, "Well, I'm going to talk to the riflemen, and I don't want you with me because you frightened them." Much later, when he was commander-in-chief of all UK land forces and Elizabeth was setting up what became a very successful organisation to support the wives and families of our soldiers, she occasionally had trouble in getting things like meeting rooms or transport. So she would ring me up and ask me, tell me of her frustration and ask if I could help. As the chief of staff, I was usually able to do that, and it caused me no bother. Presumably, on one occasion, Elizabeth must have mentioned this to Frank, and next morning he said to me, "I hear Elizabeth has been bullying you again." The same regimental sergeant major I mentioned earlier told me that one Saturday morning, he saw someone crossing the battalion square instead of skirting around it as they were expected to. He shouted, "Get off my square!" But the lone figure walked steadily on. The RSM got into quick time and advanced rapidly to give the offending person a wigging at close quarters. As he approached, he realized that the man he had shouted at was indeed his commanding officer. He said he halted and threw up the best salute of his life and said, "I'm terribly sorry, Colonel. I didn't know it was you." Frank, who'd been returning from an earlier visit to the stables, said, "I wasn't hurting your square. I was only walking on it." And he carried on and said, "Why don't you do something useful with your square, like paint a hockey pitch on it?" So on Monday morning, the PT staff were out with paint and brushes, and the battalion had a hockey pitch. On promotion to brigadier in 1970, Frank went to Northern Ireland and took command of 39 Brigade based in Lisburn. He had 6 battalions under his command, with responsibility for the whole of Belfast and the surrounding area. This was a very difficult period in the so-called troubles that beset Northern Ireland for so long, and it had a lasting and adverse effect on the Kitson family. Frank was often blamed for the internment without trial of many Catholics, but it was not his idea, and its badly targeted and low effective results were definitely not in the Kitson mould. What people don't know is how far-sighted Frank was in his efforts to galvanize his superiors and political masters into taking long-term policy decisions within which army and police operations could more successfully play their part. As we know, everything to do with Northern Ireland is beset with many complications, and not even Frank's astute analysis of the many problems brought about the results he sought. What did happen was that over many years that followed, Frank was repeatedly subjected to abusive and erroneous press and social media criticism, as well as threats of legal and actual physical attack. Obviously, this affected the family as well, and their security became a never-ending problem. For some time, both Frank and Elizabeth slept with a loaded automatic pistol under their pillow. For his exemplary service commanding 39 Brigade, Frank was awarded a CBE for gallantry, a most unusual honor. Although always concerned about the safety of his family, Frank himself took all this in his stride as he climbed to the highest ranks in the army. He commanded an armored division in Germany and then moved back to England to be commandant of the prestigious Staff College at Camberley. After that, he became the deputy commander-in-chief at Wilton near Salisbury and moved up to be the top man as commander-in-chief of all troops in the United Kingdom. Here, with his clear head and long experience, he set about reorganizing and empowering the chain of command to better fit it for its many and varied tasks, not least of which was the enormous logistical challenge in reinforcing the British Army of the Rhine in the event of an attack by the then Warsaw Pact. After less than 2 years in this important top job, Frank turned down the offer of a final role in NATO as Deputy Supreme Allied Commander Europe, as he felt that he should stay for a full 3 years in the UK top job, which would benefit from his continuity in post. This was agreed, and Frank eventually retired here to Devon in 1985, after just over 40 years in the army. And then he got out his word processor and wrote some more books. He'd already produced Gangs and Counter Gangs about his time in Kenya, and a heavier study of low-intensity operations, which was to bring about lasting change in army procedures in various different situations. He followed that with A Bunch of Five, in which he wrote of his experience in different campaigns. Then he produced Warfare as a Whole and Directing Operations, both of which are important and useful reference book for aspiring senior commanders. Changing tack, he went on to write 2 well-reviewed books on the life of Prince Rupert as a soldier and admiral, and in 2004, his final book to be published described the life of Oliver Cromwell as a soldier in a book entitled Old Ironsides. He also put together a short biography of his naval father with a collection of his paintings entitled When Britannia Ruled the Waves. And then in 2011, he had printed privately a limited edition called A Different Sort of War, a fascinating autobiography which he wrote as his memoir for family and selected friends. In his retirement, Frank became a Deputy Lieutenant of Devon and President of Devon County Royal British Legion. He was also the President of the Mounted Infantry Club and a Governor of Stow, his old school. He continued to be a keen fisherman, and he and Elizabeth spent many happy days on the banks of the Tamar. At home, they generously hosted many friends, and of course their family brought them much happiness. Frank was buried this morning, and this afternoon we say farewell, well done, and thank you for a lifetime of service to General Sir Frank Kitson, Knight Grand Cross of the British Empire, Knight Commander of the Order of the Bath, holder of 2 military crosses, Deputy Lieutenant of Devon, sometime aide-de-camp to Her Majesty the Queen, Colonel Commandant of Oxford University Officers Training Corps and the Royal Green Jackets. Frank Kitson was a remarkable soldier, a great man in so many ways. He was also good fun, and all of us who knew him well are very privileged to have done so. I hope you'll forgive me. That was 20 minutes. You all know what he thought about sermons.
Good afternoon. The family has asked me to speak on their behalf to fill in the other side of the story that General Pascoe has so brilliantly outlined. Thank you, General. Welcome, and thank you for coming from near and far today to remember Frank. I'll start with a short word from Mo, his middle daughter, who's sadly unable to be with us here today. Dad, while sitting in the front row of the church, used to tap his watch vigorously during Sunday service if the army parson got carried away and the sermon went on too long. So heaven help anyone who isn't brief, funny, and to the point today. He filled my life with unconditional love and brilliant humour. I am overflowing with gratitude and happiness that we were lucky enough to have him as a father, and for so much longer than we ever expected. I join you in spirit and on the internet to celebrate his extraordinary, wonderful, and very long life. Well, as you've heard, this extraordinary life very nearly didn't get under starter's orders. And as a result of his asthma, perhaps, to conserve breath, his maxim became ears and eyes open, mouth shut. And this was to serve him well all his life. Frank and Elizabeth's marriage was unique. They both allowed and encouraged each other to be their very best selves and to fulfill their lifetime potential. It wasn't a plan, it was just the case. They met life on equal terms with mutual love and respect. Frank had the ability to calm and soothe Elizabeth in the most stressful of situations with kindness and humor. He gave her the confidence to flourish in all her talents, and he was her rock. Who could fail to notice the pride that shone from him in everything she did? Frank's motto was not to look too far ahead. Do your current job to the very best of your ability. With Elizabeth's care and support, this was possible, and Frank certainly beat the odds on longevity. Without Elizabeth's care, he might not have done quite so well. His legendary humour, so often referred to in many of your lovely letters, developed at a young age. One of the earliest stories he tells in his recently written memoirs is of playing cards with Tom, his brother, and his father during the war, whilst bombs fell on Falmouth docks. His father was rather deaf by this stage, and so couldn't hear the whistle of the falling bombs, with the result that he jumped every time one exploded, much to the boy's delight and amusement. At school, he never liked being told what to do and led an independent existence, doubling his allowance by catching rabbits with his ferrets and selling them to the local butcher. His early tactical acumen was demonstrated by his delight at being appointed fire warden on the roof of his house to deal with any incendiary bombs that might land. He quickly worked out it was better to be up high seeing where the threat was coming from than hiding in a cellar. Like his earlier asthma attack, his military career nearly ended in disaster when he inadvertently set up his 2-inch mortar under an overhanging oak tree, with the result that the first round burst immediately overhead, showering his section with shrapnel. Luckily, no one was injured. His military career took off quickly, and his unorthodox approach was rooted in both common sense and decent humanity. He befriended many of his former adversaries, and they became lifelong friends. Indeed, he maintained contact with Kamau, a former Mau Mau terrorist, and supported him financially all his life. His deep love of nature and country pursuits was well known, but for Frank, it was always about the skill rather than the kill. It was this passion that led indirectly to his meeting Elizabeth while in search of a horse. she met his basic parameters in a bride. No asthma, no glasses, never late, half his age plus 7. Possibly a retrospective rule. So having met face-to-face 6 times, they married 6 years later. This was followed by a 6-week honeymoon in Kenya of high adventure. They were charged by a bull elephant and then became the hunted rather than the hunter when chased by a buffalo. And finally, had their boat sink under them off Malindi when the tiller broke as they crossed the outer reef and they lost all their kit. Having swum ashore and thinking it might be fun to surf shortly thereafter, Frank only had his underpants to enter the water in. Inevitably, they came off on the first wave, resulting in an awkward exit from the sea. A bit of a breather, you might say, before picking up the pace again. Danger and adventure that were the hallmarks of their whole life together. They set off to start married life in the relative calm of a civil war in Cyprus. He was fastidiously punctual, often remarking of guests that they were almost late if they showed up 2 minutes before the appointed time. On one famous occasion, Frank and Elizabeth were due out at a formal dinner, and they had arrived, as usual, very early at the venue, at which point Frank noticed everyone going in was wearing a dinner jacket. He quickly asked Elizabeth to about turn and drive him home to change. On arrival back at the venue, still very much in time, it was observed that all the guests were wearing suits. It was only the band who were wearing dinner jackets. If he was well known for his punctuality, he was perhaps less good with his personal appearance. Chiggy recalls getting told off at school about her dress and being asked, "What would your father say?" When she replied, "Dad's quite scruffy, so I don't think he'd very much mind," or words to that effect, knowing Chig, she was placed in detention for lying. A few months later, Frank visited the school to give a speech, after which the teacher felt compelled to offer her a reluctant apology. To Frank, it was not about outward appearances, but about inner metal and getting the job done. He could get irritated by small things, the rattle of a teacup during the news, or more especially during the weather, a sneeze in the back of the car. Indeed, overtaking a caravan invariably saw him shake his fist with a hearty "grrr," observed by the luckless holidaymaker as Frank sat in the passenger seat map reading. But in a crisis, he was totally unflappable and taught us that what can't be cured must be endured. He never told us what to do, but somehow, by the end of the conversation, you knew the right thing to do. Whether we did it or not was, of course, a different matter. He played the piano with gusto and by ear. Many happy evenings around the piano are fondly remembered by family and a wide circle of friends. Remarkably, he was still playing on New Year's Eve this year with a little glass of brandy. So fond was he of his favorite tipple that they named their dog Brandy as an aide-memoir as his memory began to slip. On his final evening, as Kitty was reading to him while Elizabeth was in the bath, Brandy rushed to the bottom of the stairs and barked once to let her know that he'd gone. Without Elizabeth, it's fair to say he would not have been able to balance his professional and private life so successfully. As Kitty said at your 60th wedding anniversary, "You are the best example of love we have ever seen."
Fittingly, after those two wonderful tributes, we now stand to sing our next hymn, "He Who Would Valiant Be."
a reading from the 21st chapter of the book of Revelation, beginning to read at verse 1. And I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them, and be their God. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow, nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. And he sat upon the throne and said, Behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, Write, for these words are true and faithful. And he said unto me, It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give unto him that is athirst of the fountain of the water of life freely. He that overcometh shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son.
Every life, including Frank's and that of each one of us gathered here today, is precious to God. So much so, in fact, that as St. John writes, God gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Writing some 2,700 years ago, the prophet Isaiah tells us that God has written every single one of our names on the palm of his hand. Now, that book was written in ancient Hebrew, and the word that we translate as written is actually freighted with far more than our English word implies. When we hear the word written, we might think perhaps of writing with a pen, as though it was something that could be scribbled out or washed away. Instead, the original Hebrew means something more like inscribed or engraved, or even, to use a very contemporary term, tattooed. Something which conveys permanence, because the passage goes on to tell us that God is even less likely to forget each one of us than a mother is to forget her own children. As Christians, we believe, as Frank did, that through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, we no longer need to fear death, because we have been promised eternal life through faith in him. We cannot know, of course, exactly what the life to come will be like. What we've been promised, however, is that it will be more wonderful than we can even begin to imagine, because as the reading we've just heard tells us, we will be in the presence of God, who will wipe away every tear from our eyes, and there will be no more mourning or crying or pain or death. Instead, a new heaven and a new earth. I remember some years ago, as a naval chaplain, being caught on the hop by a group of sailors when we were on a run ashore, who said to me, Come on then, Bish, tell us, what is heaven like? And I have to confess, I'd never really given it any great thought. And I said, Well, we don't know. And they said, Come on, Bish, you can do better than that. And so I said, Okay, Well, here's what I've got then. Think of the world. Think of the best of it. Think of love. Think of being gathered around your table with your family, enjoying a wonderful meal, playing games, laughing. Think of the most beautiful piece of music you've ever heard. Think of the most beautiful sunset you've ever seen. Think of walking, paddling by the ocean on a starlit night. Think of the best that you can possibly think of. God created all of that for us to enjoy in this real, tangible world. And if he created that, then I can only imagine that the world to become will be just like that, only without all the bad bits, without all the stuff that we see on our televisions, that we see day to day, all the hurt and the sadness and the wickedness and the pain. That is the best I've got, I said. And they seemed happy enough with that because they bought me another beer. Now, you might well be sitting there and you might well wish to say to me, well, okay, Padre, it's all right. You're supposed to say things like that. Surely that's a matter of faith, not fact. It's a fair question. We have no proofs for the Christian faith. In fact, all we have are witnesses, a line of witnesses to the transforming power of God's love. A line of witnesses that stretches back to those first disciples, ordinary men and women with jobs, with families to support, who chose to leave those ordinary lives to follow the charismatic Rabbi Jesus. Ordinary men and women who for 3 years walked around with him, talked with him, ate with him. They saw him angry, they saw him sad, they saw him laugh, they saw him tired. They saw the amazing things that he did. They listened to the wonderful and, yes, sometimes very uncomfortable things that he said, like a Samaritan helping a Jew, or like loving one's enemy, like God's love extending even to tax collectors and sinners. Ordinary men and women who began to think that perhaps, just perhaps, this Jesus of Nazareth might be the long-awaited Messiah, the one that the Jewish people had been waiting for, and who then watched in dismay as he was nailed to a cross and executed by the Romans. A spear rammed into his heart just to make sure he was dead. They watched him die, they took down his broken body from the cross, and they sealed it in a tomb. And they did not note then sit around thinking, well, we'll set our watches now, and in 72 hours he'll be back. No, they hid themselves away. They locked the doors for fear that they would be the next to be hunted down by the Roman and Jewish authorities. And it was those same ordinary men and women who 3 days later had to get their heads around the fact that there was Jesus once again standing in their midst, palpably real, eating with them, talking with them, inviting them to touch the holes made by the nails or to put their fists into the hole made by that spear. Those same marks on his body that 3 days earlier had been the marks of death and defeat and despair, now by the power of God were transformed into the very marks of victory. So my prayer for you all this afternoon is that you would find the peace of knowing that Frank is now at rest, safe in God's eternal arms, in that place where death is no more, where there is no more mourning or crying or pain. And secondly, that you would come to share in the hope of the resurrection, the hope that so blew the minds of those first witnesses to such an extent that they handed it down to their children and their children's children. And so it has come down through the ages and the generations to us. I'll finish with these words by the author of the letter to the Hebrews, who says this: here we have an anchor for our soul, as firm as it is sure, and reaching right through beyond the veil where Jesus has entered before us and on our behalf. Amen.
To come to thee is to come home from exile, to come to land out of the raging storm, to come to rest after long labour, to come to the goal of my desires and the summit of my wishes. Let us pray as we give thanks for Frank's life and ask God to be with all who mourn. Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, you have conquered death And for those who trust in you, its sting has been removed forever. Thank you that it is no longer to be dreaded or feared, but that it has become a gateway into the Father's presence. Father in heaven, we thank you because you have made us in your own image and have given us gifts in body, mind, and spirit. Thank you for Frank. Thank you for every special memory cherished by those gathered here today. Thank you for his devotion to family. Thank you for his dedication to duty. Thank you that now his trials and weaknesses of this earthly life are ended. As we honour his memory, make us more aware that you are the one from whom comes every perfect gift, including the gift of eternal life through Jesus Christ. As we remember Frank today, may we have the grace to say, "The Lord gave and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord." Amen. Be still, my soul, though dearest friends depart, and all is darkened in the veil of tears. Then you will better know his love, his heart, who comes to soothe your sorrows and your fears. Heavenly Father, our refuge and strength in every type of need, help and comfort all those who mourn this day. Increase our faith, dispel our fears, revive our hope, and lift us from the darkness of grief. We thank you for the comfort and support of family and friends. In this moment, we pray especially for Elizabeth, Tom, for Kitty, Mo, and Chiggy and their families. May they know the consolation of your presence and the assurance of your faithfulness. Have mercy on all who grieve. Give them patient faith in moments of fear or distress, and strengthen them with the knowledge of your love. We pray in the name of Jesus, who died for us and rose again. Amen. The Regimental Prayer of the Royal Green Jackets. Almighty God, creator and preserver of all mankind, we beseech thee in thy wisdom to guide and guard us, thy servants of the Royal Green Jacket. Make us worthy of the great traditions bound up in the union of our three regiments, and, as thy servants of old were chosen to obey with speed, may we be bold to seek thy grace in every time of need, and so be patient and persevering in running the race that is set before us. This we ask through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And if you would like to, please join with me as we close our prayer with the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
We stand to sing the great Easter hymn, "Thine be the glory."
Thank you.
to the moment when we prepare to entrust Frank to God's loving and merciful arms, our Maker and our Redeemer. Jesus said, "I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die." God, our Creator and Redeemer, by your power Christ conquered death and entered into glory, confident of his victory and claiming his promises, we entrust our brother Frank to your mercy in the name of Jesus our Lord, who died and is alive and reigns with you now and forever. Amen. Go forth upon your journey from this world in the name of God the Father Almighty, who created you, in the name of Jesus Christ, who suffered death for you, in the name of the Holy Spirit, who strengthens and sanctifies you, in communion with the blessed saints and aided by archangels and all the angels of heaven and all the armies of the heavenly host. May your portion this day be in peace, and your dwelling, the heavenly Jerusalem. Amen. And may the God of yesterday, today, and tomorrow bring you all from this place of mourning to the light and peace of a new day, where you may remember what once was and have hope in what is yet to be, and the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you all this day and always. Amen.